think Amy tries to create war in the church with that quiz, but I think we've got for a qualitative rule. So, but the start of today's gospel reads like a trailer for a movie like Gladiator. Has anyone seen Gladiator or know of it? It's one of the big films of the last 20-odd years. It sets the tone. One of grandeur, power, and no doubt for some big power plays. All the forces of the world, and institutional religion, God and the gods are set up. Listen to it like this, like a movie in the 15th year of Tiberius Caesar. Pontius Pilate of Judea, Herod of Galilee, during the reign of Annas and Caiaphas. So we're getting ready for something, aren't we? A new hero to stand up like Maximus or some Captain America or something like that, to stand up out of the shadows to face down these big powers. And what do we get? Music, dramatic sound, foreboding. The word of God, thank John, the son of Zechariah, in the wilderness. It's one of those moments where if the music was playing, the record would screech, and everyone would be like, what's this? Who is this guy? And then once the bewilderment has worn off, we say to ourselves, oh, this isn't a war epic. This isn't something filled with action. This is a comedy. It's a joke. It's just John the Baptist. He's in the wilderness. How can he face down all these powers? But that is the joke. Because it isn't a comedy. It really is the beginning of an epic battle. One that's still going on in every single human heart. So, having introduced war, I want to jump off from there and talk about peace. Because that's today's theme of the sermon. The word of God comes to John. As we hear in the first reading from Malachi, it says, I will send my messenger who will prepare my way before me. This is what kings and emperors do, who will, before entering a country, they intend to take for their own. They send their messengers before them. They say something like this. His function is to say to the people of that country, or that place that the emperor wants to take over, I don't really want to wipe you all out. Why not just surrender to me, and then you can live under me in peace. You can live under my peace. Annas and Caiaphas in the gospel who were introduced, they understood this. They were religious leaders under Caesar. So did Herod and Pontius Pilate, because they were all living under what was called then the Pax Romana of Tiberius Caesar. A peace and order of Rome built on centuries of war and conquest. John comes to announce the entry of his king into this great empire. And the warning from Malachi is very stark. But who can endure his coming? Who can stand when he appears? The Lord really is coming to fill and flatten, as Isaiah says. Every valley will be filled, every mountain will be laid low. Consider what that looks like. It looks quite dramatic, quite grand. John is here to announce that. He's here to bring another kind of peace. The Pax Romana, the peace of Rome, is going to be replaced by the Pax Christiana, the peace of Christ, in which the glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all flesh, as the reading goes, shall see it together. But there's one difference. Caesar's empires, all empires, have a blood trail. There's a huge body count underneath everything that the world calls great and peaceful. God's kingdom, too, has a blood trail. It does have a body count, but the body count is one. And the blood trail is that of the King himself, our Lord Jesus Christ. All empires, regimes, and governments rule by conquest, fear, and control. Jesus rules by being conquered, with love and forgiveness. He is a kingdom of the truly free. And that's what makes John's proclamation sound so crazy and laughable to the ears that heard it, and yet mesmerizing and attractive at the same time. He preached something completely different. Live no longer in subjugation, but repent. Think about how things can be. Surrender to God's forgiveness, and you will be free. Jesus displays this peace wherever he goes in his ministry. Jesus goes and creates comfort, but also discomfort wherever he goes. And he normally does it when he's relaxing with his favorite people. people like you and me, sinners. Consider Jesus at his most comfortable, whether it's the wedding feast at Cana, whether it's with Zacchaeus or a woman caught in adultery. Do you notice how he never seems fazed by being around these kinds of people? The religious leaders, whether they be the Pharisees or the Sadducees, are always looking on and saying, how can he spend time with them? How can he be so comfortable with them? He must be like them. Because what creates division in our hearts and division, therefore, in our societies, in our communities, is the creation of distinction among peoples. I am not like them. They are not like me. We are different categories of persons. And whenever we project onto others the divisions that are in our own hearts, by placing ourselves always in the category of the good, and everyone else, or other people in other categories, whether they be kind of okay or evil or somewhere in between, we create division. Jesus' blessing, what he brings to this battle, is this. He is absolutely comfortable with everyone. He's absolutely comfortable with sinners. One of my favorite theologians even said, almost blasphemously, do you notice how Jesus seems completely uninterested in being God? It's almost as if he's so at ease with it, he can throw it off. We can throw off our ideas of God, maybe imperial ideas, or as a conqueror, one who's going to lay our enemies low. In Jesus' kingdom, everyone is a friend. He dissolves the division between us and makes us all one. He brings us true peace. He comes to heal the divide that lives in our souls. And by healing the divide that lives in us, by helping us to surrender to his forgiveness, he comes to heal the divide between each and every single one of us. Jesus casts out hatred by loving the ones who hate. He casts out evil by loving the evil. He doesn't destroy them. He doesn't destroy his enemies. He doesn't place them under subjection. He creates the conditions by which we may be free. So we think about that in our personal lives. As we're building up to Christmas, where, God's coming. We've heard about that being a time where we celebrate the coming of Jesus at Christmas, and also his coming at the end, the second coming. And if we read any part of the book of Revelation, that can sound kind of a bit terrifying, a bit funky. The Lord is going to come as judge. He's already shown us how he judges, and he already shows us how we are to be judged with love and forgiveness. The only thing that separates us from him is our unwillingness to surrender, not the good in us, actually that which we hold on to, whether it be our sin, our stubbornness, our power, our control over our own lives. If we hold on to those things, then it's not that Jesus can't forgive us, but rather we can't allow ourselves to be forgiven. We can't allow his love into our lives. So perhaps that's what we want to think about for the rest of this Advent. What is there in me that creates distinctions? What is there in me that would like to have the victory over another person? How do I feel better than other people? However we think, if those thoughts are in our minds, they are creations of distinctions of higher and lower, of over here and over there. And Jesus comes to conquer them all. But we have to do some really hard work, and it is work. Living in Jesus' kingdom is not easy. In fact, in Luke 12:48, Jesus, when his disciples were around, he said, do not imagine that I have come to bring peace among men. What's contradicting what I'm saying? I have not come to bring peace, but I have come to bring a sword. Jesus knew that this work, this invitation, would not be easy. That the world would rebel against it, which is why his kingdom does have a body count. It's him. He is the body count at the cost of his kingdom. We all fight hard to preserve our own empire inside us. And Jesus calls us to surrender. We must do the work. We must look again, as John the Baptist called us. We must repent, look over our lives, and see what we're holding back from Jesus in this season. In his first coming, he comes as a baby. I mean, I know many of your children. I have a son myself, and I know it's getting boring for people who've heard me speak about him. I speak about him a lot. But when I look at my son, I think to myself, well, how could anyone not love him? And I'm biased. How could anyone look at a child and be conquered? You know, I'm a slave to my son. I'm completely happy about him because he inspires me with love. It's almost as if God came in this way to disarm us, to reveal to us what it is to be a slave in his kingdom. It's to be completely at one with him, completely in service, not to someone with power over us, but rather someone with power under us, who calls us to the purest and best kind of love, which, with no thought of reward, how can they reward you? All they do is mess themselves and wean and smile and cry. With no thought of reward, draws the best from us. And his second coming, which we refer to today in our Advent talk, in our preparation of the Advent brief, we get to see what kind of God returns to us. What kind of king comes to conquer and finally rule completely over his kingdom? The one built on a different kind of body count, the body of Christ. Men and women who have surrendered to that first coming, who have poured out their lives in love, who have examined themselves and come to realize that to live as a Christian in the world is to forgive, is to surrender our place, to take the last place, to not be offended, or if we are offended, to get over our offense if someone's ahead of us, if someone says a bad word, and give it all back in love. Think now. Where are Annas and Caiaphas, the men who sanctioned the religious authorization for Jesus' death? Herod, where is he? He laughed at Jesus. Pilate washed his hands in the name of Tiberius Caesar. And Tiberius Caesar, does he rule anymore? Nope, he's been in the ground for about 2,000 years. And yet Christ's kingdom is still spreading. He's still suing for peace in every single heart, flattening the divide that separates us. He is still conquered every time we sin, and yet he is lovingly reborn every time we repent. He calls on us to be conquered, to be messengers of his word, to act in his name, forgiving even before we are offended. When we address the divide in Christ Jesus' name, in our own hearts, God's kingdom grows 100-fold. Amen.